Okay, lots to talk about. Joining us here in Washington is Ahmad Majidyar. He's a fellow at the Middle East Institute. Richard Weitz is the director of the Center for Political Military Analysis. Saeed Khan is a lecturer in the Department of Near East and Asian Studies at Wayne State University. He joins us from Detroit, and also with us in Washington, right here in the studio, is Ali Imran. He's a journalist and current affairs analyst. Thanks to all of you for joining us. Ahmad, let me start with you. President Trump, as we've just heard, very critical of Pakistan. His latest criticism came in the form of a tweet, which seems to be his chosen form of communication. We can take a look at that tweet right now. He's accused Pakistan of harboring terrorists, of lies, of deceit. He's also made some comments about Pakistan. Let's take a listen to what he had to say.
We have been paying Pakistan billions and billions of dollars. At the same time, they are housing the very terrorists that we are fighting. But that will have to change, and that will change immediately.
Countries do have problems in their relationships, but very rarely have we heard it publicly expressed like this. What do you think is prompting these very harsh comments from the US president?
I think that the United States and Pakistan are on the path of confrontation. And the Trump administration believes that Pakistan's continued support for the Afghan Taliban, for the Haqqani network and their associates, constitute the single most important factor hampering success in Afghanistan. So it wants to change that. Today, the Trump administration suspended some of the security assistance to Pakistan, and barring any concrete actions against the militants by the Pakistani government, it's willing and ready to take even more punitive actions against Pakistan. And those steps could include increased counterterrorism, unilateral counterterrorism operations inside Pakistan, with or without support of the Pakistani government. It could also include targeted sanctions against Pakistani military officials allegedly supporting those militant groups. And it could also make it more difficult for the Pakistani government to receive loans and financial assistance from international organizations like IMF and World Bank. And in a more extreme measure, it could also designate Pakistan as a state sponsor of terrorism.
Richard, does the president have a point here? Is Pakistan playing a double game, or is he picking a fight with a country that is a close ally of the United States?
I think it's important to look at this in a broader context of foreign policy. In the past few days in particular, but also extending the past few months, and you see this visibly in the national security strategy, the administration is pursuing a much more aggressive strategy in terms of dealing with what they see as problematic countries. So you see very critical language and steps towards China, Palestinian Authority, Iran, and Qatar, now Pakistan. So in the context, it's just this general approach directed from the president is to try and address what they see as these longstanding problems in which President Trump feels he's not been dealt with for, and it states this in the strategy, not been dealt with for decades, and it's now fallen upon him to take action. So Pakistan, in terms of this context, is one of these issues that they'd like to deal with.
But Pakistan has been saying, Richard, that, you know, the United States is frustrated. President Trump is frustrated with the lack of success in Afghanistan, and he's looking for a scapegoat.
I think it is true that one of the things that, in the sense that President Trump said that he was very, he debated long and hard about the Afghan war during the campaign. He was critical about this dragging on, but he decided to recommit rather than withdraw. And one of the reasons why they think the war is dragging on despite right. the strong U.S. exertions is because groups within Afghanistan that are fighting, killing U.S. forces are receiving support from groups within Pakistan, particularly along the border.
Ali Imran, the Pakistanis are understandably not happy with what they're hearing from the White House. We did hear one response from the former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif. Let's take a listen to what he had to say.
There is a popularly elected government here which is not afraid of threats. We should not be given taunts of aid. The coalition support fund should not be given the name of aid or donations. We do not need such funds. Instead of deriding us about favors, you should not even insist on any support from us.
So, Ali, when you hear criticism like this, criticism that's made very publicly, how does Pakistan respond?
Pakistan has responded very candidly and frankly, and I'm surprised they have given some very, they have paid back in the same coin. They have said that, look, we have sacrificed a lot, we have fought this war, we went into places which were previously forbidden, where Pakistan where never went with combat troops. It has now 100,000 troops on the Afghan border in the tribal areas, which are fighting terrorists, and they have lost a lot of lives. And they say that we have lost about 50,000 people to this fight against terrorism, and we should not be condemned. We should be assisted in this fight. And they also, at the same time point out, add, cited by the Washington Post today, the Pakistani ambassador said that the troubles in Afghanistan cannot be explained away by just pinpointing that, pinning down Pakistan, that it is responsible for the things that are going on there. There is, ISIS has emerged in Afghanistan. There is a huge governance problem there. As Afghan government itself has said that it has not the writ of governance and government in most of the country. And then the poppy cultivation is there, which is fueling militancy, and the Taliban and other militant groups, they are using that money to fuel militancy. So Pakistan says that we have been fighting this war in the US interest, in our interest, and this is a tough situation. We should not be criticized, we should be helped. And they have said that we will continue to fight. But today's announcement, that is that looks like a very escalatory step of cutting off almost all security assistance, because Pakistan could say, can say that, look, we are fighting this war, we need this equipment, this assistance helps us fight terrorism, it provides necessary supplies to fight those terrorists. So this is a very delicate situation, and I think Afghanistan being a fulcrum in this right. whole region, it can be a fulcrum of stability. It can be a fulcrum of terrible chaos. The chaos will affect South Asia, right. India, Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, China. It will affect Central Asia. So, I mean, if Pakistan just removes those troops, or it just scales down its military presence on the border, and right. militants have a field, they can cross over back and forth freely. You know, you can imagine what kind of situation can arise from such a step.
All right, let me bring in Saeed Khan from Detroit. And Saeed Khan, let's look at the military relationship between the United States and Pakistan. Pakistan provides valuable logistical assistance to the United States. In fact, it provides the supply routes through which U.S. supplies gets to its forces in Afghanistan. Surely the United States must be aware that it's placing that in jeopardy with this kind of criticism.
Exactly. And I think what we find here with the current president is a bit of myopia about the historical relationship that Pakistan and the United States have had really since the inception of Pakistan in 1947. It's the only non-Western country to belong to two different defense configuration agreements, both CENTO, the Central Nations Treaty Organization, and CETO, the Southeast Asia Treaty Organization. And along with that, a stalwart member of the Cold War, a frontline ally. And we have to remember that the conflict with Afghanistan has been going on really as far as its impact to Pakistan for about 40 years since the Soviet invasion in 1979, a situation and a cooperative relationship with Pakistan which has cost that country an incredible amount of destabilization, bringing both the Kalashnikov and the poppy to a culture that did not have it indigenously before. Also, obviously, since 9/11, the battle with al-Qaeda, and we find that despite the fact that there are some structural issues with Pakistan, with its military, with its all-powerful ISI intelligence force, the United States has until now taken a very pragmatic approach about that. They have understood that there are glitches in the system, but they've been willing to work with them and even overlook them at times. The fact that now they're going to create a much more porous border, as was mentioned before, and a lot more military jeopardy, if not for American troops, then certainly for erstwhile allies over there, is bewildering to members in the Pentagon, as well as in the Department of State, as well as the CIA currently.
Ahmad, to what extent is this dispute driven by the fact that what may be Pakistan's security priorities are different from America's security priorities in that region?
I think that's the core of the problem. Like, I agree with the other speaker that Pakistan and the United States have been allies for more than 7 decades now, from the very inception of Pakistan. But from the very first day that we see that the two countries have had divergent interests. In the 1950s, the United States partnered with Pakistan for the reasons of Cold War. But Pakistan's main concern even at that time was India. So Pakistan wanted to empower and strengthen its military with US support against India, but India was not an issue of concern for the United States. The only time that I remember that I can talk about that the interests of the two countries converged, that was during the 1980s, during the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan. But even after that, we saw that the two countries were about to divorce in the 90s, that the United States put sanctions on that. And even today, the US and Pakistani interests in Afghanistan are completely divergent. Pakistan sees the Indian presence in Afghanistan as a threat to its security. It wants to use the Taliban, the Haqqani network, as a proxy to undermine the Indian presence and also project its influence in Afghanistan and beyond. While the United States wants to get rid of those groups and stabilize Afghanistan and make sure that Afghanistan will not become a safe haven for terrorism again. I think that about the tweet that you showed before, I would agree with that, but with a caveat. The Pakistani government has supported the United States with supply routes that you mentioned, and also against Al-Qaeda, certain elements. But the problem has been that the Pakistani government has pursued a selective approach when it comes to fighting militants. It has acted against the TTP, which is the Pakistani Taliban, and other groups that are targeting the Pakistani state. But at the same time, it has provided safe havens and other forms of support for the Afghan Taliban and other terrorist groups which are targeting Afghanistan and India.
So, Richard, we hear of these divergent security interests in that region, different for the United States, different for Pakistan. Is that a divide that can be bridged?
That's a tough one because one solution would be for the U.S. to side with Pakistan against India, but that's not going to occur. I think that India enjoys much stronger support within at least Washington in terms of its foreign policy orientation and regional importance. I do want to stress that the U.S.-Pakistan relationship is not adversarial completely. I mean, it's a mixture of cooperation and conflict. So we get a lot of cooperation against terrorism from Pakistan. They partnered well against the Soviet occupation in Afghanistan. But there are divergences. The main Pakistani security priority has been India, and the U.S., it's not. Looking ahead, I can see a potential win-win, at least in the short term. I think that if what might happen, and this may be part of the administration strategy because they're doing it elsewhere, is that they're thinking they can reduce the U.S. costs, U.S. aid, and displace that burden on other countries, particularly China, possibly Russia. So if China were to, as is possible, fill the gap for any cutoffs in U.S. aid, the risk here is that the Chinese priorities, of course, are not totally coincident with the U.S. either. There's opposition to terrorism, but there are also some incentive to encourage the Pakistanis to use whatever tools they can against India, which is a main Chinese rival. So it's a bit unclear, but you could certainly see how we could end up better with the current strategy, but you can also see how you can end up with a lot worse.
Ali, do the Pakistanis have a point when they say that the United States has failed to recognize what Pakistan has been doing in the fight against terrorism? And I mean, look at some of the very big campaigns that Pakistan has conducted over the past few years, the campaign in the Swat Valley, North Waziristan, in the federally administered territories as well. Has there been a failure for the U.S. to recognize what Pakistan is doing?
What happened was this year when President Obama announced a plan to pull out the big number of troops from Afghanistan, it sent a signal to the region that perhaps Washington will not be in for a long-term engagement. So Pakistan, on the other hand, look, there are three very, very important bilateral relations that are at play here. One is Pakistan-Afghanistan relationship, which has deteriorated. The other is Pakistan-India relationship, which is already strained. And now the US-Pakistan relationship, this is also worsening with these steps. And if the US has good relations with Pakistan, and if Pakistan and Afghanistan can improve their relationship, this can help a lot. As far as India is concerned, Pakistan's concern has long, for a long time, it has been Pakistan's concern and argument that if India gets an influential position in Afghanistan, it can create difficulties for it in Balochistan. And they have also caught an Indian spy who has confessed to being part of the Indian apparatus to fuel insurgency in Balochistan. So, I mean, and secondly, you know, I would like to draw your attention to the very, very important point that the clip you played of the former prime minister, he said that this is an elected government. So this is a very, very changed situation now. And we have to remember that 2018 is going to be the election year in Pakistan.
Right.
So no political leader or party can afford to look weak in the face of US criticism. I mean, this is a very, very tough situation for both countries.
But the military is very powerful in Pakistan as well. Do you think the comments that President Trump has made is going to have the effect of actually uniting the civilian and military branches in Pakistan?
Yeah, if we look at their last week's statements, you know, they have already united them. And they are on the same page, the Pakistani foreign minister, defense minister, who are civilian elected leaders, right. And Pakistan military, they had meetings on the same day, and they came up pretty much a similar strategy and similar announcements. So, I mean, this is, but I would also like to bring to this discussion the high stakes that US has, because, you know, US has invested so much with time, money, treasure, and blood in Afghanistan. Its mission, it cannot be accomplished, or it cannot be rounded off in just a few months, you know. US announced its strategy in August.
Right.
So we cannot say that, you know. I mean, it has high stakes. It has to have, it has to keep open the door of diplomacy. You
okay.
know? It cannot annoy a very important country like Pakistan.
I will get to you in a moment. I just want to get to Saeed Khan. Saeed Khan, I want to ask you this. There were some comments made by a very senior official in the president's National Security Council which suggested that the United States should avoid portraying Pakistan as an ally, and it should strip Pakistan of its status as a major non-NATO ally. What is the impact of that, and how will Pakistan look at that?
I think it's a rather myopic statement and assessment regarding Pakistan for two reasons. Number one is certainly the international community will see this kind of petulance as being yet another example where the United States may seem to be shying away from commitments that have been long established with other countries. And so those countries are going to have to then reevaluate what kind of commitments they want to have with the United States, whether it's in a military capacity or even more broadly when it comes to economics. Second of all, when it comes to Pakistan, we are no longer living in a bipolar Cold War paradigm where any kind of dismissiveness by the United States would be seen as then giving Pakistan the only option of gravitating toward the Soviet Union, which, of course, it didn't do in the Cold War. But there is the very real reality that American frostiness toward Pakistan will simply draw Pakistan more closely to China. Now, we're talking about a $255 million military aid assistance package, which is to be suspended. China is investing $62 billion in infrastructure investment, 243 times the amount that the United States is hoping to hold hostage when it comes to Pakistan. So that, along with the fact that Pakistan and China are cooperating in the construction of the JF-17 fighter jet, shows an immense level of connectivity between China and Pakistan, two countries which have had very long-standing relations, very good relations, and ironically, Pakistan serving as the conduit to help the United States normalize relations with the People's Republic of China in 1972.
Right.
In fact, Pakistan might find this as being rather liberating, that with China, it doesn't have the same kinds of strings attached when it comes to aid and cooperation that it feels it might have with the United States.
Okay, Ahmad, go ahead.
Yeah, I just wanted to raise two quick points to what was just discussed before. I think that you raise a very important point, because when President Obama announced the withdrawal of troops, the timeline from Afghanistan, I was actually in Islamabad, and I remember one of my conversations with a top military official who told me that the United States is just leaving Afghanistan, so we are uncertain about the future of the country, whether this political system will survive. So we have to maintain our ties to the Taliban as a hedging strategy for just any eventuality in Afghanistan. So that's why I think the Trump administration has reversed that timeline-based approach and has changed it into more conditions-based approach to send a more positive message of an enduring commitment to Afghanistan in order to encourage the Taliban that the United States is not leaving Afghanistan, so it should come to the negotiating table instead of continuing war, and also to encourage Pakistan to bring the Taliban to the negotiating table instead of just continuing support. And in relation to the question that you asked about the unity between the civil and military relations, while the public response has been more kind of unified, but deep down we see the discussions inside Pakistan about soul searching. Ousted Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif gave a very strong statement, and he accused the military of self-deception. He said that why we are not being heard across the world despite the sacrifices that we are rendering in the fight against terrorism, so we have to stop some of the policies that hurts Pakistan and hurts the region.
Right. Richard, to Saeed Khan's point about the growing relationship between China and Pakistan, let's take a listen to what the Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi had to say. Let's watch.
The government and people of Pakistan have made huge efforts and sacrifices in the fight against terrorism, and everyone can see. The international community should recognize that. We think that Pakistan has done its best on anti-terrorism issue. Some countries should give Pakistan the full credit it deserves.
So a very different view from China there. Do you see this lead to some kind of realignment in Pakistan's interests in the region?
Oh, no. I think their China-Pakistan alignment is already very, very strong. I think that China is Pakistan's favored ally. Polls show they're much more popular than Americans. China provides much more aid. It's not, as our colleague said in Detroit, without strings. It's just the strings are a little different and more comfortable for the decision makers in Pakistan. And Pakistan's relationship with Russia is beginning to improve. They've had beginning to have joint military exercises. So I suspect this may reinforce those trends, but it's not going to mark a fundamental shift. I mean, I think that the key to securing a change in Pakistani behavior, as with North Korea, is it's going to have to involve greater Chinese desire to press these countries to restrain from terrorism or missile testing and so on. The way I would phrase it is I think that with respect to the Afghan conflict, I mean, the Chinese are also working with the Taliban somewhat. They're meeting with them, they're talking with them, and they work with the government. So they're also pursuing a hedging strategy. The way I see it is the ending Pakistani support for, or substantially cutting back Pakistani support for the insurgents in Afghanistan is a necessary condition to ending the conflict, but it's not sufficient. I agree with what was said earlier that even if that occurred, there's some other, a lot of problems within Afghanistan that need to be addressed to end it. So I'm not sure this will have much of an impact overall in terms of the alignments of these countries. It will potentially reduce U.S. costs, increase U.S. credibility, but a risk of backfiring if the U.S. influence declines because Pakistan is an important country.